I have to say, I feel like a rock star. This is amazing.
Wow, so many wonderful humans out there.
Not so skeptical now, are we, about psychology?
Love life and enjoy every moment.
So guys, I've got 18 minutes to do what is essentially a 30-minute talk. So I need to make sure that everybody's brain is focused and in the room and present. So I need everybody to copy me, please. So that should be your right hand that's out. How many people got their left hand out? We always get a couple. Now with your left hand, I need you to point your finger at me. So we should have one thumb up, one finger pointed. Now what I want you to do is engage your brain and switch. And back, and again. And again, and again, and again. Should be quite easy, right? But apparently it gets easier after a few drinks, so you can try that later on. Okay, guys, so I want to talk. I'm just going to get straight into it and talk about seven things that, if you do them on a daily basis, will enhance how your body performs, but also how your brain performs. So the first thing, hands up, who has had a workout today? Okay, all the people with their hands down, look at the people with their hands up, because their brains are functioning better than yours right now. What we know, there's so much evidence out there about the benefits of exercise for the brain that I can now say unequivocally that if you do not engage in regular, vigorous physical activity, there's not a snowball's chance in hell that your brain is functioning optimally. We know that exercise has a huge impact on cognitive function and particularly executive functions, that complex decision-making, planning, judgment. We also know exercise is really important for driving neuroplasticity in the brain, which helps protect it against Alzheimer's disease. Exercise is also very important for our mental health because it releases endorphins. Other feel-good chemicals such as endocannabinoids, dopamine, serotonin are all stimulated by exercise, and it balances out our two major neurotransmitters as well. But the other thing that's hugely important is that exercise has a very powerful driver of your gene expression. Every time you exercise, there's what we call a triphasic response of your genes, and it's initiated by stress response genes that happen when we exercise, and they kick off a whole cascade of metabolic priority genes, and then things called mitochondrial enzyme genes. So your mitochondria is like the batteries of your cells, and they actually get better when we exercise. So it's very beneficial at a cellular level for your body and for your brain. So the next one is a little bit left of center, right? And it's about having cold showers. And you might think this is a little bit crazy, but a randomized control trial, which is the best form of evidence done recently, showed that people who had, and they split them into two different groups, half of them they asked to have a 30-second cold shower at the end of their normal shower, and then and do that for a year, and then they measured their health and absenteeism at the end of the year. The people who had regular cold showers had around about a 30% reduction in sickness and absenteeism. And if they regularly exercised, they had a 55% reduction in sickness and absenteeism, which is pretty huge. So this is my little guy, Oscar. Now, the reason he's like that is he's about 3 seconds into a freezing. Now, by the way, we're just back from Bali. He doesn't normally have those things in his head. So this was last year. He's about 3 seconds into a freezing cold shower. But before anybody calls the police on me, the reason he was in a cold shower is I'd just read the research, and I decided I was going to have cold shower. So I was having a 20-second cold shower, and Oscar just happened to walk into the bathroom, and I'm there going, trying to control my breathing. And he said, "What are you doing, Dad?" And I said, I'm having a cold shower, mate. And he went, "Okay." And he went to walk out of the room, and he stopped, and he went, "What are you doing that for?" So I said to him, "Because it makes you tough, mate. And I just finished the cold shower." And he went, "Ah, interesting." He said, "How long did you do?" And I said, "At 20 seconds. He said, "Get out. I'm going to kick your ass," right? So this is Oscar 30 seconds into his cold shower, doing what he calls box breathing. And then I said to him, "Mate, that's 30 seconds. And he just turned the shower off, walked out of the shower like this and went, "Loser." Not competitive at all, little Oscar. But so what happens, the science behind this, when you have a cold shower, expose yourself to cold, any form of cold water, norepinephrine is released in your brain. And that is a stress chemical, but it's also a feel-good chemical. And it turns out that that chemical upregulates your immune system, which is why these people actually had less sickness. The World Health Organization has now endorsed cold showers as good for your health as well. And it's because of these stress response proteins. The same ones that get released in exercise are actually released when we expose ourselves to cold water. But for me, as well as all of this science, part of it is a psychological reason, because it helps develop grit. But it is quite tough to be in that lovely warm shower and to choose to flick it to cold. And this is about getting comfortable with being uncomfortable, which is pretty key if you want to have long-term resilience. So that's cold showers. The next one is mental rehearsal. So for this, I need to talk about the voices that are in your head. You know those voices? You all know the negative character that we have in our head. So your homework is to go home tonight and give that character a name and bring them to life. What do they drink? What do they wear? What foodie team do they support? But most importantly, what are some of the things that they say? Now, this other character in your head is about you at your best. And it's about that bringing that character to life. Same thing. Importantly, what are some of the things that that character says, particularly when you're feeling under pressure? And then it's about visualizing that character. So it's writing down some of the signature strengths that this character has. But then I like to take it a step further and to use external role models to create an internal role model. So if you like, this is like an Uber you. You at your best plus a little bit of something. So you pick people who either you know or you've read about who have traits that you would like to have, and then you add them to this best version of yourself. And then it's about bringing that character to life. And I'll talk about this in a second, but this is an example of my little girl's one. So there's her negative character, Millie. So she drew this when she was about 9. Now look at Millie's body language, right? And she's saying, what if no one likes what I'm meaning? And there is her powerful character, Shaka. I don't know if anybody's seen Amy Cuddy's research on power poses, but Shaka's doing a power pose. Shaka stands for, I think it's something like Amazon War, sorry, no, Great Warrior in Zulu, right? And so it's about visualizing that. Now, this got really brought to life to me just before Christmas. We were in regional Victoria at a karate competition. Both my kids do karate, and they both compete. So Kira was doing kumite, which is where kids fight in a kind of controlled manner, right? And she was fighting off for a gold medal, and she went to do a head kick on this girl. I'm talking about kicking people in the head at a happiness conference. But anyway, she went to do a head kick on this girl, and this girl blocked it, and Kira slipped and fell and hit the ground and screamed. And I could see, I was sitting on the edge of the mat, and I jumped on straight away because I knew her arm was broken. And I used to do helicopter search and rescue when I was in the military. And I knew that I had to give her a pretty calm exterior. So I jumped onto the mat, she's screaming, and I said to her, Kira, she said, what's happened to my arm, Daddy? And I said, I think your arm's broken, but it's gonna be okay. We need to do our box breathing. I'll talk about that in a second. And so she's starting to calm down a little bit, doing her box breathing. Then the medic came on, they phoned an ambulance. So Kira's doing her breathing. Then the ambulance guy came on and said, we can't get an ambulance here for 2 hours. So you're gonna have to take her to the hospital. And the medic said, we've got to take that glove off and we've got to put a splint on it. And I told that to Kira, and she said, this is gonna hurt, isn't it? And I said, yes, it probably is. And she said to me, Daddy, I need to find Shaka. So I said, okay, you find Shaka. So she starts doing her visualization, doing her breathing. We did all that, got her into the car, drove her to hospital, went to hospital A&E, and it was an hour and a half before they give her any pain medication. They wanted to x-ray her first, and then the x-ray came back, and this was the x-ray. So you can see the top bone is completely snapped and the bottom bone is broken. And when I was sitting in with the x-ray guy, me and Oscar were there, and the x-ray came out, and Oscar looked at it and he went, oh my God, he went, Kira, you're so cool, right? When's the last time an 11-year-old boy told a 7-year-old boy told his big sister that she's cool? The thing for me, Kira did not cry after those first 2 minutes by doing that visualization and using the box breathing. So for me, it was really a really poignant example of how this stuff works. And actually, not to forget about that, the big take home is to get your game face on. Every morning before you go to work, get your game face on. What you are you going to choose to bring to work or to a social interaction? Before any meeting or any social interaction, just spend 20 to 30 seconds visualizing you at your best. What you are you bringing to this interaction? Because we know you affect the brain chemistry of every single person you interact with. So choose to bring your best self. And the most important time to get your game face on is when you come home at night. Because that, when you walk into your house, you affect the brain chemistry very significantly of everybody in your family. So just get your game face on. And the more often you do it, the easier it becomes. Now, the next one is about recharging our brains. And so for me, there's two elements of this, right? One is about what I call movement snacks. We know that prolonged sitting is a really awesome way to rot your brain. So how long have you guys been sitting for? Right, so can everybody stand up for me? So we're just going to do a little, what I call a movement snack. And in order to do this, I would like everybody to sprint on the spot for 30 seconds. Now, I don't mean this. I mean as fast as you possibly can. Not yet. I love your enthusiasm. Not just yet. Actually, let me change the psychology. What I'd like you to do is I'd like you to sprint as fast as you can on the spot for 10 seconds, and then I want you to hang in there for another 20 seconds. Notice the difference in psychology? If I see anybody pace themselves, we will do this again. At about the 15-second mark, you're going to realize you do not want to do this again straight away, and you're on camera, by the way. So we're going in three, and here's the most important thing. At the end of it, you need to high 10 three people within 5 seconds, and I want a shitload of noise when you do it. Okay, so going in 3, 2, 1, and off we go. Give me some noise, people. That's a bit better. Excellent. If you wanna have a good time, that is 10 seconds. Stop me now. 15 seconds, you're halfway there. Let's bring it home hard. 20 seconds, let's go. Bring it home hard. You got 5 more seconds. 4, 3, 2, 1. High 10s. Go, go, go. Awesome. Okay. So the next bit to this is when you've done 30 seconds of exercise and you've burnt up the stress hormones that have been running around your body, is to do box breathing. Anybody ever heard of box breathing? Excellent, quite a few people. This is what US Special Forces do when they're on patrol to control their arousal and put their brain in an optimal state. And we now know that when you breathe like this, so you breathe in 2, 3, 4, hold 2, 3, 4, out 2, 3, 4, hold 2, 3, 4, nice and slowly. You either do it 3, 4, or 5 seconds. What you do is you have what we call bottom-up control of the vagus nerve. It reduces your heart rate, reduces your blood pressure, and brings your brain out of a stress state. So when you do that little bit of a movement snack and then box breathing, it's like taking your brain out and plugging it into the wall to get a recharge. So the next thing is I need to talk about just before we go to sleep. And this is about a digital detox, right? What we know is that if you interact with a screen or a device within 30 minutes of going to bed, melatonin, your sleep hormone, drops by almost 30%. That means you're less likely to get to sleep and you're more likely to wake up in the middle of the night. Now, some people say to me, what the hell would I do for 30 minutes without a screen? Well, that's where meditating, doing some box breathing, just reading a book, helping your brain to unplug, having a warm bath to cool your core body temperature, which will help you sleep. It's really essential that we help our brain to decompress. And having that 30 minutes without interactions with the screen is hugely important. We know that if your sleep is affected because you've got low melatonin, you're more likely to be stressed the next day. So your stress system is switched on, and most people get that. They're tetchy whenever they have a lack of sleep. But what we also know is two hormones, leptin and ghrelin, are changed. Ghrelin, your hunger hormone, goes up. So you eat more food, and because cortisol is higher, you crave sugary, fatty, and salty food. Leptin, which is your off switch, is reduced, so you eat more, and actually leptin controls voluntary physical activity, so you're less likely to move, which is a really bad way it's a good way to not control your stress, if you like, is not moving. So then this whole cycle perpetuates. So just try to have that 30 minutes, which will really enhance your sleep. Second last one I want to talk about is gratitude, and I think it was Phil talked about gratitude earlier on, so I won't run over the same ground, but what I and I'm preaching to the converted, I'm aware of this, but this was a meta-analysis done back in 2002 by McCulloch, and he found that people who regularly practice gratitude have more positive emotions, they have higher levels of well-being, they have more hope and optimism. Two things that Dennis Charney found are really important for long-term resilience. They also are more empathetic, they're more forgiving of people who wrong them, they've got less depression, less anxiety, they're less materialistic, and they're less envious. Hands up if you'd like all that. That shit's free. Absolutely free. 2 minutes a day is all it takes just to think about the stuff you're grateful for, or you can write it all down and laminate it and read it, or you can just do a gratitude ritual randomly. What am I grateful for? You can journal. There's a number of different ways you can do gratitude. If you struggle with it, try going for a day without it. People say, yeah, we got electricity, but you know, I struggle to be grateful. Well, turn all your electricity off for a day. Then you'll start to appreciate it. Don't have running water for a day. That's a really good way. The Stoic philosophers talked about going without the things in your life to really start to appreciate them. So the last one I want to talk about before I sum up is about, and I was thinking about nutrition. I'm a registered nutritionist, and anybody who tells you there's a one-size-fits-all either has no idea what they're talking about or they're trying to sell you something, right? Because we know there is no one-size-fits-all when it comes to nutrition, but there is one practice that benefits absolutely everybody, and this is relatively recent research, and it's a 12-hour night fast, nil by mouth other than water. And some of the research that came out quite recently showed that women who have a 12 to 13-hour night fast have a 36% risk reduction in breast cancer, which is pretty huge. Now, how we know this works is at night when it gets dark, your suprachiasmic nucleus in your brain governs your circadian cycle, and it switches on a whole heap of bodily repair mechanisms. One of them is your DNA repair enzymes. They run around your body looking for cells that have become defective and become precancerous, and they delete them. What we know now is that you have peripheral clocks in your liver and your pancreas, and when you eat late at night, you switch those clocks on and they turn off your DNA repair enzymes. So the best way, the proper way to interpret the research, which is what these researchers said, is that if you eat late at night, you likely increase your cancer risk by 30 to 40%. Animal studies have been showing that it's across all different types of cancers. So it's just eating in concert with our biological rhythms. Now, I'm just about out of time, but just before I sum up, I want a quick favor, because it's Oscar's birthday when I'm at this conference, so he's missing his dad's not at his birthday. And when I was talking about it, he said, Dad, that's okay. You go to the conference because you're going to be famous. But I said to him that I would try to get somebody to sing happy birthday. So would you guys mind when I go 3, 2, 1, we'll have 1,500 people, just happy birthday to Oscar. You guys know the girl. So Oscar, here's a little message from people. That is awesome. That'll make a little boy very happy. So guys, I do want to sum up. This is the point where I'm supposed to leave you guys with a positive mental association with me and all that horse shit. But I'm not a motivational speaker. I'm a realist, and the realist in me tells me I've got to give you guys the bad news, because the bad news is real. And the bad news is that no one is coming. Seriously. Ever. No one's coming to sort your shit out. They're just not. No one's coming to make you happy, to achieve your goals, to make you a peak performer, to make you a role model for your kids. They're just not coming. This is all about you, and it's all about the choices you make every single day. So the last word goes to Morpheus. And do you choose the blue pill of cruising through life, maybe indulging a little bit more in the finer things in life because, hey, you only get one shot, and not getting out of your comfort zone too much because it's just not pleasant, but ultimately not achieving your true potential? But do you choose the red pill of actually setting some big goals around your health, but more importantly, doing daily practices like these seven habits and other things that you'll see from other speakers in this conference, and doing them every day and ticking them off on a ritual board and seeing what that does with how you interact with the world and how that impacts on your potential. The choice is all yours. Thank you.